Hello, my name is Ron George, and I'm a fellow at Duke University, and we'll be talking about MPA, or microscopic polyangiitis. Today, we'll talk about who gets MPA, regarding incidence and prevalence, and cover the basic clinical features that patients with MPA demonstrate. Throughout this talk, I'll try to highlight differences between MPA and GPA Wegeners. The two are different pathologically and in the result of serologies, which are the autoantibody profile of MPA and GPA. Finally, we will cover treatment for these two vasculitides. To summarize our objectives, I'll start with who gets MPA, move to clinical features, pathophysiology, and end with treatment and a summary. MPA, or microscopic polyangiitis, is an ANCA-associated vasculitis. The vasculitides, which are a group of autoimmune diseases that attack the vasculature, are often divided by the size of the vessel they affect, namely small, medium, and large. Additionally, vasculitides are also grouped based on the result of a laboratory test, the ANCA. Two other types of diseases that have positive ANCA tests are granulomatosis with polyangiitis, or GPA Wegeners, and the Sherg-Strauss syndrome. MPA is described as affecting small and medium-sized vessels such as capillaries, venules, and arterioles. It is a necrotizing vasculitis based on pathology indicating areas of necrosis in the affected vessels. ANCA stands for anti-neutrophil cytoplasmic antibody. The ANCA test is reported based on the pattern of staining seen on indirect immunofluorescent staining of ethanol-fixed neutrophils. It represents antibodies that are targeted against constituents of neutrophils or monocytes. The two patterns are either C for cytoplasmic or P for perinuclear. Each pattern is associated with an autoantibody, C-ANCA with anti-PR3 antibodies, and P-ANCA with anti-MPO antibodies. For P-ANCA, the association to remember is anti-MPO antibodies, referring to antibodies against myeloperoxidase, an enzyme present in the neutrophil. For C-ANCA, it is anti-PR3 antibodies, which are against proteinase 3. More on this later in the talk as it relates to the specific disease. The annual incidence in Europe ranges from 1 to 11.6 per million inhabitants, and the prevalence is around 0 to 94 per million inhabitants. The peak onset is between ages of 65 and 74. It is more common in men than women, and very rare in children. MPA, along with granulomatosis with polyangiitis or GPA Wegeners, and anti-glomerular basement membrane disease or good pasture disease, is considered a pulmonary renal syndrome, meaning it commonly affects the lungs and kidneys simultaneously. Unfortunately, the most common presentation of MPA is that of a patient with pulmonary hemorrhage or diffuse alveolar hemorrhage. Patients with MPA will also have renal disease that is a rapidly progressive glomerulonephritis. Patients in retrospect describe a prodrome of fever, malaise, and may have pain in their joints and muscles, which are called arthralgias or myalgias. MPA is an immune-mediated process and is considered to be an auto-inflammatory state. This disease has systemic inflammation evidenced by elevations in ESR and CRP, which are nonspecific but support diagnosis in the right clinical setting. Patients also generally have anemia due to either loss of blood from pulmonary hemorrhage or nephritis, as well as chronic inflammation. Since MPA causes glomerulonephritis, patients present with elevated serum BUN and creatinine. Additionally, patients with MPA demonstrate active urine sediment with casts. Finally, as mentioned earlier, the P-ANCA test is positive and usually due to the presence of anti-MPO antibodies. On the right is a nice picture of the peripheral staining consistent with a P-ANCA pattern that is seen in most patients with MPA. Clinically, you should think of ANCA-associated vasculitis such as MPA or GPA Wegeners when you see a patient with a prodrome of aches, pains, fever, and recurrent pneumonia, especially if there is hemoptysis. The lab findings above can serve to confirm your thought process. Often, overlap does exist between MPA and GPA Wegeners. The good news is that treatment of each process is similar. Here we have an X-ray of an individual with bilateral congestion. This appearance can represent pneumonia, congestive heart failure, or hemorrhage in the appropriate clinical setting. Systemic necrotizing vasculitides are severe disease for which treatment carries significant additional risks of severe complications. Therefore, in all possible cases, a tissue diagnosis is the gold standard and should be obtained in a safe manner without placing the patient at risk from complication. Of interest, lung and kidney biopsies in MPA reveal similar findings and distinguished MPA from GPA. Kidney lesions reveal a focal and segmental glomerulonephritis. Here are two images revealing a large number of dark staining inflammatory cells along with fibrin deposition and thickening of the renal epithelial cells. The injury to the kidney results in leakage of plasma proteins, or fibrin, causing renal epithelial cells to proliferate and thicken, compressing the glomeruli. In the low-power image on the right, the intense staining fibrin can be seen leading to thickened epithelial cells that look like a crescent, hence the name. Crescent formation results in the loss of glomerular function. Closer up, we see a better picture of the multitude of inflammatory cells and a single glomerulus with fibrin and a crescent forming. Specifically in the lung, we see inflammation surrounding capillaries. Because of hemorrhage, the lung will demonstrate findings consistent with interstitial fibrosis. In contrast to systemic lupus erythematosus, in which immunofluorescent staining of tissue biopsies reveal deposition of immunoglobulins and complement that indicate antigen-antibody complexes, in MPA lung, kidney, and often skin sections, there is a lack of significant immune deposition, which is also termed palsy immune. In biopsy sections, MPA does not have granulomas in contrast with GPA, Wegener's, and Sherg-Strauss syndrome, which are pathologically characterized by the presence of granulomas. Additionally, MPA tends to be more chronic, new and old damage concurrently, appearing, and patients have a prolonged course of relapses and flares. Again, a key point is that MPA affects small and medium-sized blood vessels. Therapy for MPA is tailored to the severity of the presentation. In all cases, glucocorticoids are the first line because they work in a matter of days. Steroid-sparing immunosuppressive medication is used once your diagnosis is confirmed. For severe MPA with renal and lung involvement, intravenous cyclophosphamide is given as a monthly pulse with the dose adjusted to achieve a nadir in the patient's white blood cell count. This usually ranges from 3,000 white blood cells to 4,000 white blood cells, 10 to 14 days after treatment. Treatment with cyclophosphamide for MPA is typically 6 months. Recently, the use of the anti-CD20 antibody rituximab was shown to be non-inferior to cyclophosphamide in a large clinical trial of patients with Wegener's, /GPA, and MPA. Once therapy with either medication results in remission, a less potent maintenance immunosuppressive medication is started, generally azathioprine. Methotrexate is another treatment option for maintenance or as a primary treatment in milder cases. To wrap us up, MPA is an ANCA-associated vasculitis in which pulmonary hemorrhage and kidney failure are common presentations. MPA is most commonly a P-ANCA-associated vasculitis that is confirmed with the presence of anti-MPO antibodies in 80-90% of patients. Anti-PR3 antibodies are rarely seen with a P-ANCA pattern. Biopsies reveal a small to medium necrotizing vasculitis that is palsy immune and without the characteristic granulomas seen in GPA Wegener's. MPA is treated with immunosuppressive medication in an induction regimen followed by maintenance therapy. Thank you.